situation on that. So it's basically, I would describe myself as an atheist, but that's because I'm pretty sure there's no God. A funny story about that is when I was a Christian even, I like to even sleep with a nightlight on, you know. Who knows what could happen, you know. But now it's kind of like, you know what, I don't believe in God anymore. I don't believe in anything supernatural. It's kind of like, hey, this is for fun. Let's turn off the light and see what happens. Come on, I dare you, boogeyman, where are you? Where are you, spirits? Let's go find a haunted house. Let's go visit it. Oh, there's no haunted houses here? What? You know, it's like, I'm calling them out now, and it's like, let's see what you got, you know, now that I'm ready to face you. And it's like, there's nothing, you know, nothing there to deal with. The problem with atheism, though, is taking a stand for atheism, it's not really a positive declaration. An atheist says what you aren't. You're not, you don't believe in God. Okay, so what are you then? You know, so that's where secular humanism is good, because it says, you know, these are principles that we believe in. And as far as I like to define humanism, secular humanism, because there's different kind of humanisms, I think we should say secular humanism. I think I like to keep it general and just say that secular humanism stands for a naturalistic worldview. We look at everything from a naturalistic standpoint. And also we lift up reason and science. And so, you know, from there, let's debate everything else. Let's, you know, instead of being too narrow and saying democracy is the best way, I think it probably is, but instead of making all these, you know, definite statements, let's just say, you know, we'll talk about all that. Because sometimes secular humanists, people think they're too liberal or whatever, and there's no reason to think that secular humanists are liberal. Why not just say we stand for reason and science and, you know, critical thinking, and just leave it at that? That's my view. Did I have a second part, or did I answer that?
And family and friends, how they view now?
Yeah, so when I left Christianity, it was very tempting to say, okay, I'm just going to woodwork and I'm just going to live my life, you know, and just forget about all this. But then I thought, you know what, for the sake of my kids, I should, you know, teach them what I know, because I went to seminary, have a seminary degree. You know, it'd be selfish for me just to fall back and just enjoy life. You know, I earn it to myself to tell other people. So, especially for my kids, and if I'm going to do it for my kids, I might as well do it for society. So I kind of went after people, like I go after pastors, you know, and stuff, and say, yeah, let's talk about this, you know, and I find out, you know, I thought as a Christian that they're always looking for people to talk to, but, you know, as I'm looking for people, even for people to debate, you know, I'm finding that it's hard to find them to come forward. It's like, what is this? I thought you guys, you know, taught apologetics and evangelism, and you only want to talk to people who don't know anything? Is that the way it is?
So, oh, yeah.
Hey, question here?
Yeah. Question?
Yeah. I had a comment. So, you know, it's true that religion, I think, is a lot of times invented to deal with the fear of death, you know. But I am not so sure that it actually solves the problem. I heard somewhere that Christians fear death more than atheists do. I need to look that up, because I can't recall what it was, but there was a study. But, you know, something like 40% of our total healthcare costs go to last-ditch efforts that don't do any good. You know, end-of-life healthcare costs, 40%. And it's because they fear death. So they're dying, they're it's imminent, they're saying, take whatever steps necessary to keep me alive another day. This is a country that something like 80% of the people are Christian. But they are desperate. They fear, evidently fear death so much that they're willing to have a liver transplant even though they, you know, are dying, whatever it is, right? Mm-hmm. So I don't believe that Christianity solves the problem. You'd think it'd be just the opposite. It's like, oh, finally, I'm tired anyway. I want to get to heaven. Yeah, pull the plug. I'm happy with that. You know, it's just the opposite.
I guess speaking for myself, I was an evangelical Christian, but I would have been one who would say that I would believe in a mercy killing or whatever. You know, if you're gonna die, it's and wither away in a coma, and you'd rather head that off by taking your life and saying goodbye to your friends. I mean, I'm a Christian who would say that I'm fine with that. So I don't really understand the Christian perspective of trying to keep the machines on for the last minute. And then being a person who really did believe in heaven and all that, I mean, I know lots of probably older Christians. I mean, there's too many of them probably, like Harold Camping, who are like, oh Lord, why so long? Take me today, please, not another day, you know? And I'm ready to go home, you know. There's a lot of people who, you know, they're ready to go and they don't care if the whole world goes too, you know. That's time to pick us up, you know. The young kids, they're like saying, no, Jesus, hold on there, you know, I got some life to live here. John?
That study that Phil's referring to is a 2008 JAMA study, which showed that at end of life, that those who identify with being more religious use more resources. And I think, however, that in our culture, Christianity is a label that is used, and so I don't think the researchers in the surveys are differentiating between people who maybe are living their faith a little bit more than just identifying as Christians. You know, I think you have to be careful about that generalization in our culture, because they could call themselves Christians and utilize resources, but if you went to their house and looked at the pornography or looked at how they were living their lives, they might not meet the real definition of a Christian.
Right.
So that was one comment that I have, that thinking might be a little bit flawed. And the other thing is, Bernie, can you take a few minutes and tell us what you're doing right now in CFI and stuff, and some of your activities that some people may not know about, especially since you mainly do a lot of your stuff on the West Side, although one of your groups did meet in Russia, you know, for some of the talks. So why don't you tell us about what you're doing now?
You know, also a comment on your thing about different Christians, you know, some believe it more heartily or practice it more than others. I've heard, too, that, you know, some atheists, they get upset when a Christian will say to them, you know, you need to believe in Jesus or you're going to go to hell, you know, and it's like, I never understood why people would get upset with that. It's like, I don't believe in God or hell, so it doesn't have any effect on me, but some atheists, it makes them upset. And I think I saw a poll one time where some atheists, you know, they're not really sure, so maybe there is, you never know, there could be a heaven and a hell, and they're telling me I'm going to hell, so I don't like that, you know. So, you know, everybody's different, I guess. As far as groups, on CFI, I organized some debates. This is in conjunction with CFI, but it's my own group I do. There's one called the West Side Science and Religious Science and Religion Discussion Group. You go to meetup.com, and there's another one called Vancouver Science and Religion Discussion Group. So this coming school year, there'll be almost monthly debates and discussions on there. And then also, I'm just starting a brand new group. It's called, it's an experiment on religious naturalism. It's basically saying, okay, there's no God, so what about spirituality? And among atheists, this is a debatable thing. There's a podcast with CFI where they talk about both sides, but they have atheists on both sides, so they pretty much cover all the bases that you can imagine there. I mean, some atheists will say, don't use the word spirituality, it's only valid if you believe in God. And others will say, no, spirituality is something where, you know, you could express yourself through art and music and all kinds of things, you know, it's just a word, don't get too hung up on the spirit part of it. So it's a interesting debate. So anyway, this book we're studying, and it's kind of a devotional book, the way it's written by a person who's kind of a pioneer in this field. Her name is Ursula Goodenough, and basically starts off each chapter with hardcore science, like, for example, the origin of the earth or biology or whatever. And then the religious component is, how do we make sense of this through the eyes of evolution, basically, through naturalistic world eyes. So anyway, it's all about evolution, because that's how we got here, was thanks to evolution, you know. So there's cosmological evolution besides just biological evolution. So let's have some, over here.
Personally, I find the you're going to hell thing is a personal thing, and that's why that bothers me. But also, I just wanted to ask how long your journey took when you first started questioning when you decided you were atheist.
Probably about a year and a half, but it was like an intense, like, you know, I'm every day I'm, you know, listening and trying to read. I'm listening to different podcasts and everything, you know. So it's a year and a half of compressed time where, you know, if somebody only listens to a podcast once a week or whatever, you know, it'd take them a lot longer. So, does that answer your question?
Yeah.
I was going to ask if it's really true that Christians are more fearful of death than atheists. I'm wondering if it's because they're worried that they aren't ready.
Could be, but I mean, for me, I wasn't more worried about it.
Okay.
I mean, for me, you know, you want to live life and experience it, but, you know, like I think it was John or somebody said, you know, you should think that, I mean, I would tell my kids, what's heaven like? Nobody knows, but I would say, you know, imagine the best possible thing, and what's that? Disneyland. So, okay, it's the best possible thing times a billion, you know? So it's,
but there's,
it's
going to
be great.
According to legend, there's St. Peter at the gate, and he's going to see if your soul is free of sin. Mm-hmm. I think most people know that their soul is not free of sin.
Well, see, as an evangelical Christian, I would say it's because you don't know the gospel, because the gospel is you're a sinner, yes, but Jesus paid the price fully for you. So if you fully accept Jesus and follow him, you're in. There's no doubts about it, you know?
What about Catholicism, which is, I understand, a little bit more works generated? So,
yeah.
You know, if you die before you give penance and stuff, they might
right.
have more worries.
Well, yeah, I mean, in Catholicism, if you have a mortal sin, that means you're going to hell when you die. So you can't even get out of it. But if you're a Christian, it's not too bad. You're going to purgatory, and you can get out of purgatory eventually to heaven. But eventually purgatory is going to empty out probably into heaven. But if you did a mortal sin, like it used to be a mortal sin to eat meat on Friday, or eat fish on Friday, I think. Yeah, I can't remember. Fish or meat, one of those on Fridays. So what does that mean? Those people who did that now are in hell, but now they do it and they're not in hell. But, you know, it depends on what country you're at, because some countries still have it on, that's a mortal sin. So, you know, in America, it's not a mortal sin, but in other countries, it still is, you know. So it's, Phil?
Question about the spiritual atheists. So would you call that a faith-based position, though? Or is,
well, okay, so basically I would say that secular humanism, it could also be called metaphysical naturalism. For example, Richard Carey's book he wrote out, it's called Sense and Goodness Without God, A Defense of Metaphysical Naturalism. So basically what metaphysical naturalism is you take the natural facts of the world and you can build upon that and say, since we know this, then maybe this stuff is also true. We don't know, we don't have evidence for this. But we're proposing that that's true based on the facts, the knowledge we have. So I put our faith, and that's our belief system, about what it is, and that's metaphysical naturalism. But you know, the Christian would say, oh, you know, this is my belief, and it's not based on facts, it's based on the Bible, or what I want, you know, whatever I hear, or whatever. So the difference there is, the belief system, is it based on facts, or is it based on the Bible, or based on some other holy book, or divine message from somebody.
What would you tell a group like this that maybe is interacting with Christians or Jehovah's Witnesses or whatever about what you've learned and what you're trying to do in your own life right now in terms of approaching people who have different worldviews and beliefs?
I guess part of my, I think part of me is, you know, I know in the end nothing matters. It doesn't, you know, nothing really matters. Everything gets burned away anyway. You know, pretty soon the last star is going to burn out. So, you know, while we're here, you know, have fun. And so this is something I decided to do and try to have fun at it. So I don't really care if people want to be believers or not. So, you know, I just try to tell them, you know, the facts and things. And I think they appreciate it because I'm not trying to push something on. It's like, hey, you know, here it is. Believe it or not, we can talk about it. But, you know, I don't have any kind of urgency that I need to save them or anything like that.
Oh.
So I think my advice might be just to keep it kind of light and not so serious, because sometimes, you know, people, especially atheists I've seen too, they can get really quickly into personal attacks, you know, like, oh, you're Christian, then you must be an idiot or something, you know. Just, that's the number one thing, I think, is to probably avoid personal attacks, even between atheists, you know.
I've seen there are a lot of interesting works in anthropology about things that look a lot like evangelism growing out of fundamental cognitive dissonance that you believe. If there are things that, you know, are supposed to be happening according to your belief and they're not happening, and it makes you feel uncomfortable, one way to resolve the discomfort is to create new converts to your belief system. And that shows up, you know, in all kinds of people.
Yeah, but you know what, sometimes those things, they can cut both ways. I mean, I hear things like that, you know, said against religious people, but the religious people can say it about atheists too. It's like, well, you know, atheists don't have any evidence, and so they just try to convert each other. That's why Richard Dawkins is out there, because he'll feel better if he gets more converts, you know.
Well, maybe he's suffering from cognitive dissonance.
Could be, or maybe he...
I don't know.
Yeah, or maybe he just thinks he sees the truth and he sees some obvious error. And I mean, this is my viewpoint, is that he's, you know, he's...